Good afternoon. We have general questions. Question number one, Iain Gray.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress the Cabinet Secretary for Justice has made on implementing plans for the introduction of video link facilities and family hearings in those towns where courts are to close.
Cabinet Secretary Ken McCaskill.
The Scottish Court Service commitment in video links was to establish a link in the vicinity of the town where a sheriff court would be closing. They're introducing this in a phased stage, and plans are well advanced for those closing in November 2013, with potential sites identified and evaluation work underway.
Iain Gray.
Well, I think the Cabinet Secretary's answer it really reveals that the words that were given for those courts which are closing in 2015, for example, my own hometown of Haddington, were indeed just warm words to take the sting out of an unpalatable decision. And indeed, the Court Service, or the Crown Office rather, have recently confirmed that the Fiscal Office in Haddington will also close as a result of this decision, another huge vacant site in the middle of my hometown's High Street. I thought the Cabinet Secretary believed in community payback by vandals. So when is he going to start paying Haddington back for his vandalism in closing the town's courts?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Mr. Gray will be aware that Haddington's not due to close until January 2015, and clearly the courts are referred to that are closing before then. Work is ongoing. Matters change, times change. Mr. Gray will remember, because I've been checking, and I note that all out of hours, that's emergency child protection orders for Lothian Borders, including Haddington Sheriff Court jurisdiction cases, are actually dealt with in Edinburgh Sheriff Court. This arrangement has worked well since 1999. I know that at that stage, Mr. Gray wasn't the elected representative for East Lothian, but I do recall that he did serve as a Justice Secretary for the then Scottish Executive, and this matter would have been aware to him. So, as I say, it does seem to me rather hypocritical that when matters are taken to protect children, when he is in office, no criticism is made. When matters are taken to progress justice overall, as we face tightening budgets from south of the border, as the Scottish Court Service protect the integrity of the system, matters are criticised by him.
Roderick Campbell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I understand from my own correspondence with the Scottish Court Service that they're setting up transitional planning groups to oversee the transfer of business from courts which are closing, such as Cooper Sheriff Court. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure me that the Scottish Government will do all it can to assist these transitional planning groups in bringing forward plans, including the rolling out of video facilities and family hearings?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, absolutely. I have every confidence in the Scottish Court Service taking forward these plans and working with stakeholders. SCS intends addressing the needs of vulnerable witnesses as a priority and will build on the platform of this provision to examine opportunities for extended use of video technology within the terms of legislation, current and future, to apply this to other types of procedure and hearings, including family hearings. So I can give Mr. Campbell the commitment that this matter is being taken forward regarding the particular community in which he lives. But it's also a matter that the Court Service, in conjunction with the judiciary, are seeking to extend as much as possible to make justice better, simpler, and indeed provide protection, especially for vulnerable witnesses.
John Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of mobile banks, mobile libraries, mobile breast screening units, mobile MRI scanning units, all of which can be moved by road to appropriate destinations. Has he considered the possibility of creating mobile court facilities in a similar way as an alternative to video links to meet the legitimate concerns, particularly of witnesses having to travel very long distances to give evidence?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, that's an interesting thought. It wouldn't be within my domain, given that these are matters ultimately for the Lord President and the Scottish Court Service. But I think the matter that Mr. Scott refers to is an appropriate matter, but the courts have always had these matters. As a defence agent, I have taken evidence in people's houses. I have also in my past actually attended at people's beds in hospitals where sheriffs took evidence in these manners. So this matter is available where there's a clear need, where it's unable for the individual perhaps to attend there, as Mr. Scott will have seen even on television, where locus visits, for example, are carried out. I think we already have the system that allows for the flexibility to ensure that these matters can be dealt with, but it is a matter I'm happy to feedback to the Lord President when I meet with him later this week, and I'm sure it's a matter that he will take on board, because he does understand the requirement for making sure that people do have access to justice.
Christy Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I refer the Cabinet Secretary to the closure of Peebles Sheriff Court and the proposed joint feasibility study to delivery of justice services in the borders at page 6, where it refers to all opportunities to provide a technology solution will be investigated. Can I take it that is not in place of a proposed justice centre in Galla Shields?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, the work on technology is ongoing, not simply with regard to the courts, as I said to Mr Campbell, that are due for closure, but in terms of a Making Justice Work programme across the judicial sector here in Scotland. These matters are not either or, they're not mutually contradictory, and indeed, though, I do understand that Scottish Court Service has already had bilateral discussions with Scottish Borders Council. A remit for a feasibility study has been agreed between the Court Service, the Council and justice organisations to assess the most efficient, effective and economically advantageous method for future provision of an integrated justice service for the borders. And indeed, the feasibility study group met earlier and is taking forward wider engagements with victim support, women's aid and other such organisations.
Question number two, Lewis Macdonald.
To ask the Scottish Government whether the participation of police officers makes a positive difference to road safety education in schools.
Cabinet Secretary Kerry McCaskill.
Well, Police Scotland is committed to partnership working on road safety issues. They've established the Trunk Roads Unit, supported by 14 divisional road traffic units, to ensure national coordination of local delivery of roads policing. Within Mr Macdonald's area, it's for Chief Superintendent Mark McLaren, as a local commander, to work with partners locally to shape and deliver road safety engagement. And I understand that there's been direct engagement with pupils to support safety on the roads at Market Hill Primary School in Inverurie and at Fockaber School, and the police are working with the Moray Housing Partnership in response to road safety concerns. In addition, Police Scotland engaged in the Safe Drive, Stay Alive campaign, the A947 study group, Be a Better Biker, and run a number of car seat clinics at a variety of locations across the area to provide better advice and guidance to parents.
Lewis Macdonald.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Does he agree that the principle of preventive spend should apply to road safety as well as to other areas, and that police investment in road safety education is a very good way to spend to save? If he does agree, can he tell us how Police Scotland will continue to do that in regions such as the North East, where the police in the past have been very actively involved in road safety education? And in particular, can he tell us how they will approach community planning in order to continue the very good work as a community planning partner previously done by Grampian Police?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't think it would be appropriate for me to comment for the police. I think if Mr Macdonald has that particular question, he will no doubt put it to Mr Murray, who's head of the road policing unit. But I do think it appropriate that we should point out that road safety is a matter taken very seriously, not just by the police, but by the government. But the 1988 Road Traffic Act, Section 39, puts a statutory duty on local authorities to promote road safety, also to undertake studies into road accidents and to take steps both to reduce and prevent accidents. And I think that's a matter that's ongoing. As a former Transport Minister, Mr Macdonald would be aware of that, and indeed doubtless taking on board as a former Shadow Justice spokesman. So the primary responsibility put down in the Road Traffic Act lies with the local authority. But the police, as I mentioned, are doing everything they can to work with, because this is a matter that everybody has a responsibility to keep people safe on the roads. The statutory responsibility for education rests with the local authority. The police have statutory duties going with their powers as Office of Constable, and I'm sure together they will help to make Scotland's roads safer still.
Alison McInnes.
Much, Presiding Officer. Road safety has until now been a multi-agency partnership. There are five core partners defined in statute for the community planning process, police being one of them. What does the future hold for community planning in light of the Chief Constable's reported view that Police Scotland is not a solutions agency, rather it is a restraining agency?
First, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, having spoken to Steve House, I think people should listen to what Steve House says, not what's necessarily reported allegedly by him. I think the position here goes back to the point I made to Mr Macdonald. There is an issue. We do face problems in a variety of Scotland, not just rural areas, but there are particular problems in rural areas in Aberdeenshire, in Fife, in the southwest of Scotland, with young men in particular losing their lives. We have to educate those going to school, because we've seen tragedies. We have to educate those who go on to the roads to avoid further needless deaths. This is a responsibility for each and every one of us. What has happened here is that the police have looked at matters. It's quite clear that the statutory duty rests with the local authorities. That is a situation I know from experience here in the City of Edinburgh, but when I've been down with the local authority, been with the Education Department, with the teachers, I've also been present with local police officers who have come in. It's how we work together, each of particular roles. We can and must make Scotland's roads safer, but that action is about working together. Equally, there are matters that only the police have powers for in terms of taking action on the roads because of the Office of Constable and the powers. There are other matters in terms of the 1988 Act that whether transport ministers or indeed justice ministers, we know that the responsibility rests with the local authority.
Before I call Stewart Maxwell for question number three, can I just say to members that I really want to make progress through the questions, so I'd appreciate very much brief questions and brief answers. Question number three, Stewart Maxwell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made on implementing an injury surveillance programme.
Cabinet Secretary Ken McCaskill.
Following the success of the assault injury surveillance model in Lanarkshire, the Scottish Government recognised that this programme could be very valuable to both NHS Scotland and Police Scotland. We're working with a range of partners under the Building Safer Communities programme to reduce the harm and to seek to roll this out. So there's a project underway, and this includes a national assault injury surveillance programme.
Maxwell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that I first raised the issue of injury surveillance in 2005, and I remain committed to the belief that it will be an effective measure. In the first year of trials in three NHS Lanarkshire sites, figures have identified that unreported crime is falling faster than reported crime, and the overall crime is steadily decreasing. I recently wrote to the Cabinet Secretary urging the Government to press ahead with the implementation of the system across all NHS boards. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what challenges the Government has faced in rolling out the system of injury surveillance?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm grateful to Mr Maxwell for raising this. I know his long-standing commitment here. There has been problems over data sharing, but they are being overcome, and that is why, in partnership with the Violence Reduction Unit, we are seeking to roll the project out nationally. I'm grateful for the pilot in Lanarkshire. I'm grateful for the support and the endeavour of Mr Maxwell in driving this forward, and I can give him an assurance that we're seeking to build upon that commitment.
Question number four, in the name of Mike McKenzie, has been withdrawn. The member has provided an explanation. Question number five, Duncan McNeil.
To ask the Scottish Government, when the Cabinet Secretary for Justice last met the Chief Executive of the Scottish Court Service and what was discussed.
Cabinet Secretary Ken McCaskill.
I meet the Chief Executive of the Scottish Court Service regularly. The last formal meeting was on 26 March when I was given an update on SCS plans.
Duncan McNeil.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his reply. In the last three financial years, offenders in Scotland have received a staggering 450,000 warning letters for defaulting on their fines. On top of this, 200,000 court citations and 90,000 arrest warrants were also issued for non-payment between 2009 2012. In my own constituency, three offenders have amassed nearly 100 unpaid fines between them. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that those figures show a serious weakness in our justice system, and what will he do to address this serious problem?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I did read Mr McNeil's press release prior to his question, and I can only indicate the response. 89% of the value of Sheriff Court fines imposed between 1st April 2009 and 31st March 2012 have been paid or on track to be paid. This government, through the Court Service, is delivering. Changes have been made to improve the system that we inherited from our predecessors, allowing, for example, action to be taken in earnings arrestment, for example, to take people's caravans, cars, and so on. Fine enforcement officers are delivering. Much, much more could be done if the Scottish Court Service, whether in terms of court closures or indeed of enforcement, actually had access to funds and wasn't facing the cuts coming from the coalition government south of the border. It's surprising, therefore, that Mr McNeil still prefers a system where so many of these fines, mounting millions of pounds, routinely go to the Treasury in London rather than being available for justice here in Scotland. Maybe he should consider that.
Question number six, Nanette Milne.
Thank you. Can I ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to install average speed cameras on the A96?
Cabinet Secretary Nicola Sturgeon.
We have no plans to install average speed cameras on the A96 trunk road.
I
thank the Minister for that response, and I have to say I'm relieved to hear it, because similar opposition to that expressed regarding the average speed cameras in the A9 has been expressed in Aberdeenshire regarding the A96. But can the Minister tell me, what evidence the government has been given that speed cameras have actually improved accident rates, and will ministers agree to publish detailed information on each speed camera site, including accident rates and how much has been raised in fines?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would be, of course, happy to discuss this issue in more detail with Nanette Milne. The question was about the A96, obviously, and while there are no plans to install speed cameras, average speed cameras in the A96, she will be aware of the improvements, the safety improvements that have already been made on the A96 trunk road and those further improvements that are planned, including, of course, a recommendation about reducing the speed limit on the A96. In terms of her question about average speed cameras, she will be aware that average speed cameras have delivered casualty reductions where they have been permanently deployed in the UK. That said, we recognise the need to very carefully consider the suitability of this particular tool for use on a case-by-case basis. Detailed consideration has been made to ensure that such a scheme is fit for purpose on the A9. Obviously, there are particular factors in the A9 around length, forward visibility, geometry, junction spacing, vehicle speeds, etc. And these have all informed the decision that have been taken. But I would, of course, be happy to discuss the matter in more detail with the local member if she wishes.
Question 7, Richard Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what recent progress it's made in taking forward the business rates incentivisation scheme.
Minister Derek Mackay.
I can confirm that causal leaders took a decision at their meeting at the end of May that they did not want to consider the review of the 2012-13 business rates incentivisation scheme targets until the final non-domestic rates audited figures for 2012-13 are available. I can confirm that these audited returns are not due to be submitted until the 31st of January 2014, with the final validation not expected until the 28th of February 2014.
Richard Baker.
Thank you. The Minister has confirmed there is no agreement between councils and the Scottish Government that ministers were justified in their dramatic moving of the goalposts on this business rate scheme's target, which meant that Aberdeen Council, for example, will receive only £300,000 rather than £5.8 million to invest locally. When this review is concluded, will it actually mean councils can invest more of these funds locally and honour the commitment given to councils by ministers?
Minister.
I think Mr Baker has misrepresented the circumstances here. The same rules and the same agreement applies with local authorities. They've asked for time to consider the returns. The Scottish Government's more than happy to give local authorities the time to look at their own returns, ensure that they're properly audited, to make sure they make the right decisions in terms of this particular scheme. Particularly in relation to this, we did agree that if there were significant events, we would look again at the targets. That's what has happened in terms of a significant event in the shape of the loss of re-evaluation appeals. And touching on Aberdeen, of course, Aberdeen will get what it's entitled to, but Mr Baker should be aware that in studying the facts, the overall of the rateable value of non-domestic properties in Aberdeen actually reduced by £4.3 million over that financial year. So I'm sure that Mr Baker will more closely study the facts in future.
Question number 8, Linda Fabiani.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it has made on implementing the Home Energy Efficiency Programmes for Scotland.
Minister Margaret Burgess.
The HEAP schemes were launched on the 1st of April this year, and to date we've issued offers of grant for area-based schemes totalling just under £46 million, which will see 25,000 to 30,000 households receive around 40,000 measures to improve the energy efficiency of their home and help tackle fuel poverty. We have also signed a memorandum of understanding with three energy suppliers to deliver the affordable warm scheme, and from April to the end of August, a total of around 3,500 referrals have been made. Finally, from April to the end of August 2013, around 2,100 referrals have been made to the energy assistance scheme, with over 700 completed installations reported.
A brief supplementary and answer, Linda Fabiani.
Yes, I thank the Minister for that. But I would be interested to know, particularly for my own constituency, how many households have been helped so far by these schemes from this Government. And I wonder if the Minister could arrange for these figures to be collated.
Minister, briefly.
Yes, we will collate these figures and certainly keep the member up to date. But I can tell her that £2.2 million has been allocated to South Lanarkshire Council currently. Thank you.
Okay, we now move to First Minister's questions.